Good morning, everybody. My name is Eric Auger. I work at Red Hat in the virtualization team. And this talk is about the QEMU ARM Virt machine and recent activities done to improve its scalability overall. So this is the outline of my presentation. So I will start with a brief introduction about MacVirt machine itself. And then I will cover three types of scalability issues. So some of them are already fixed in QEMU 3.0. Those are related to the vCPU count limitation, PCI bus topology. And then I will mostly focus in this talk in a work in progress related to improvements related to the guest RAM size expansion. And eventually we will conclude. So let's start with a brief introduction about Virt machine itself. So it was introduced about 5 years ago. It's a bit special as a machine, as it does not match any real hardware, as opposed to many numerous other ARM machines. So it was devised as a minimalist machine to run general purpose operating systems running in ARM 32-bit mode, so compliant with the V7 architecture. And over the time, the machine has been upgraded for running server-based operating systems running in 64-bit mode and compliant with ARM V8. And so in KVM accelerated mode, nowadays it is used to run a real server class workloads because so what has been added in the machine is typically a PCI bus topology where you can plug VIRT.io PCI emulated devices. And also many system peripherals were added over the time, like the generic interrupt controller V3, MSI controllers like GeekV2M, ITS, MSI controllers, the system MMU was added recently. So it is able to run a significant number of A-profile CPUs already and brings a large amount of RAM. So this is not fully server-based system architecture compliant. This is an ARM specification that standardizes hardware to run a server for server-based system. And there is a discussion ongoing on the mailing list to define a so-called SBSA reference QEMU platform, which would be easier to handle for people writing low-level firmware or trusted firmware. But the scope is fully different, as this platform would aim at being run in TCG mode, whereas Virt can do both, actually. So we could ask ourselves what is wrong with this machine, because it looks already fine to run production workloads. So the fact is that nowadays we have access to some systems with more than 200 physical cores, a large number of I/O devices and terabytes of RAM. And as a matter of fact, if you look at a picture just before QEMU 3.0, the Virt machine was suffering some important limitations in at least three domains. The number of vCPU count was limited to 123. We had only 16 PCI buses, and the amount of available RAM was 255 gigabytes, which is a bit limited and does not scale compared to what we have at physical level and on other PC machines like Q45, for instance. So let's talk about the first limitation related to the number of vCPU count. So the actual problem of getting stuck at 123 vCPUs was related to the GeekV3 redistributor region. We had a single redistributor region. And so let me explain what is a redistributor. So each time you integrate a CPU with a GeekV3, so you need a so-called redistributor. So this consists in two 64 kilobyte pages of registers, which are memory mapped. And those registers typically allow to set up and control interrupts tightly tied with the CPU, like software-generated interrupts, PPIs, private peripheral interrupts, and MPIs. And so those redistributors, are packed into so-called redistributor region, so in a contiguous manner somehow. And the problem is that also the device tree and the CPI specification allows to expose several discontiguous redistributor regions. Sorry. In practice, the in-kernel emulated GigV3 device was not able to handle more than one redistributor region. And the one we had was cornered in between two other I/O regions, and it couldn't go actually. So we had no other choice but adding support for more than one redistributor region in the in-kernel GigV3 device. So this was done in 4.18 kernel. And now we have this capability to register several redistributor regions. And so those I/O regions are properly handled. And concurrently, so we added another redistributor region in QEMU. So it was done in QEMU 3.0. This new region is now 64 megabytes large. And it has been put on at the 256 gigabyte base address. So now you have the capability to support more than 512 vCPUs. But actually, we hard-coded this 512 vCPUs max number in the KVM instead. But there is no limitation anymore on the number of vCPUs we could support. If we need to, we can easily add a new redistributor region elsewhere. And it does the job. So now we have the same capability as on other PC machines, for instance. So the second limitation we had was related to the PCI bus topology. And the limiting factor in this case was the ECAM MM configuration. So this is a flattened memory mapped space for configuring PCI endpoint functions. So each bus takes 1 megabyte, and we had 16 megabytes, so 16 PCIe bus indexes were available. So the problem is that the limitation is quite important, because each time you instantiate a root port, so it consumes one bus index. Then if you instantiate switches, upstream and downstream port also consume a PCI bus index. And so 16 PCI buses is very limiting, all the more so that you can only outplug PCI endpoints onto downstream ports. So we were limited on the number of outpluggable PCI endpoints. But in that case, so we had no choice but adding a new ECAM region and deprecate the other one. So now, by default, we use 256 megabyte ECAM region in the IMM region. Because adding a new ECAM region would mean that we had a new bus segment, so it was not possible. So now, by default, we are using this new ECAM region. So unfortunately, this is not compatible with some configuration. Typically, if you have a firmware running in 32-bit mode, it will not work, and in that case, you need to use a legacy 16 megabyte region. And also, of course, if you have an LPIE guest, a non-LPIE guest, so you need to use the IMM option and to set it off to force the usage of the 16 megabyte ECAM region. So now let's look at the limitation on the maximum amount of RAM we have on the guest side. So first of all, so now we need to run huge VMs. This is a use case typically to run workloads like in-memory analytics or huge databases on the guest side. And 255 gigabytes is not sufficient anymore, so we would like to reach terabytes of guest RAM. Now, if you look at the existing memory map that is used in MacVirt, so it is stuck at 1 terabyte because we had a limitation in KVM for ARM. So I will explain this limitation and how it has been lifted. And so on ARM, we only have what is called initial memory. So we have no device memory as in PC and Q35 machines. So I will explain what it is also. And we have to define a proper memory layout, which is one of the most important challenges. So until very recently, actually, there was a limitation in KVM for ARC64 on the maximum size of the IPA space. So the IPA corresponds to the guest physical address space. Actually, this is the input of the second stage of the MMU. And KVM for ARM was assuming that the maximum IPA size was 40 bits, and everything was hard-coded in KVM. You had three levels of translation. The start level was hard-coded. The configuration registers was also hard-coded. And this was true for all the VMs in the systems. And now this limitation has disappeared thanks to Suzuki's series, which is quoted here. And now you decide of the size of the maximum size of the IPA space when you create the VM. And the stage two table geometry now is fully dynamic. Control registers are saved into the state of the VM. So now it makes it allows to use more than 40 bits, and with the 8.2 architecture, we can reach up to 52 bits of IPA, so guest physical address. So we can use much more than 1 terabyte. So there are still some limitations. Typically, the number of levels being used in stage two must be less than or equal than the number of levels used in stage one. And the max IPA size depends on the host kernel config and the CPU being used on the host side. It must be noted that there is still a physical address limit in EDK2, which must be fixed. And so we will need to address that soon. So as I explained before, so currently we only have initial RAM, so the one that is specified using the dash M option. We don't have device memory, so the one specified using the max mem and slot option. We would like to get the support of this device memory in MacVirt, because it will bring flexibility and also new use cases. Because this device memory, so you provision for a space where you can plug memory devices. Those memory devices can be, so originally this was PCDIM, now you have NVDIM, VirtIOMEM, VirtIOPMEM. So all those use cases are not available on ARM. And so you could use NVDIM pass-through, direct access on guest. You can optimize the footprint of the guest using cache page optimization, and VirtIO MEM also brings an alternative for ballooning, which is very interesting. Unfortunately, ARM64 does not support memory unplug, so there were attempts to support this, but those attempts were stopped in November 2017. However, we can still cold plug the memory. Okay, now with respect to the choice of a RAM layout, we have basically two alternatives. Either we use a split memory model where we keep the initial RAM at 1 gigabyte with an amount of 255 gigabytes, and then we add some extra memory, so device memory at 2 terabyte, for instance. So this is easy at QMU level. There is no change in the firmware. However, so there are some limitations. If the end user specify more than 255 gigabytes of initial memory, so this cannot be supported. There is no device memory available below the 1 terabyte limit. And also, so this kind of split memory model caused issues on PC machines because you have compatibility issues whenever you want to add new ranges, new memory, new device, or you want to carve out some region. So this is not flexible. So now there is discussion on the mailing list to migrate to a new memory model where we would have only a single memory region whose location would depend on its size. And this could be, if it is small, this could fit at 1 gigabyte, or we would move it to 2 terabytes typically. And the trend would be to use device memory instead of initial memory, meaning that typically, yes, I need to speed up. Typically, you would transparently convert initial memory into memory device plug. So it's more flexible, and it would allow also to clean some fake NUMA code in QMU. However, it has a firmware impact, and on QMU side, it's part of a larger refactory too. Okay, so on the firmware side, the problematic we have is that EDK2 currently assumes that memory starts at 1 gigabyte. And so we need to change that. We need to identify all the codes that hardcode this address. And also we will need to pass information from QMU to the firmware in one way or the other. So several alternatives were studied, typically passing the DTB base address in X0 register or using the firmware config device to pass the RAM base. Another alternative would be to have a 1 megabyte SRAM region and keep the memory outside of this. So the last point I wanted to mention is that since we are studying the possibility of having a dynamic memory map, this could take into account this problematic of host IOVA reserve region. This is a problematic that happens when you assign a device to a guest. So in that case, VFIO maps the whole guest RAM through the IUMMU. And the guest programs the assigned device DMA register directly in GPA. So obviously, this assumes that the GPA will be eventually translated into host physical address by the IUMMU to reach the actual memory of the guest. However, there are cases where the IOVA that is programmed, which equals to the GPA, cannot be used for some reasons, typically because it might be interpreted as a peer-to-peer transaction between two endpoints within the same group if the PCI SES is not enforced. So in that case, the transaction will not reach the physical IUMMU, and the actual transaction will not reach the guest RAM. So you do not reach your goal. And there are other cases where the GPA can reach the physical IUMMU, but can be bypassed. There are cases where the BIOS is requesting identity mapping at the physical IUMMU level. So Shamir worked on this problematic and tried to, at kernel side, to enumerate all the reserve regions, the IOVA reserve regions, and through VFIO SCTL expose them to QMU, which would then carve them out from the RAM layout. Unfortunately, we were stuck just before landing into 4.18 because there is a kind of false detection of IOVA regions for graphics and USB devices, which expose some reserve regions, which actually are not harmful for the system because they are used just before the boot. And after that, they are not jeopardizing the integrity of the system. So globally, so the IUMMU API is exposing some reserve regions which should not be exposed, but we cannot easily remove them because the IOMMU subsystem is using this information as well. So as a conclusion, we remove the limitation on vCPU count and PCI topology. We are fully reworking the memory map with a larger IPS space. And we are considering also the addition of device memory. But on ARM, so we have at least two features which are missing today, vCPU hot plug and memory hot plug. And we have this problematic of host IOVA reserve regions, which is not ARM specific and impacts also all the other platforms actually. So thank you for your attention. So any question now?
Thank you. So what's the plan for EDK2? Do we have, so I guess we've had at least for the more than 40-bit IPA. How extensive are the modifications required in EDK2? And is it something that we can tackle in a short amount of time?
Yeah, okay. So for the 40-bit IPA limitation, I don't think this is much work to do. I discussed that already with ARP, so it should be okay. However, I'm more concerned about changes related to the floating RAM base because, as I mentioned, we have two problematics. So identify all the pieces of code that hardcode the address, and also we have to define a good way to pass the information from QMU to the firmware. And we have not chosen yet this way.
Yeah, one thing I'd really like to avoid is that we end up with a large collection of EDK2 implementations that we would use depending on the topology of the VM. I'd like to stick with one AVMF binary that we can use on any VM, and that's really what I'm concerned about here. Mm-hmm.
This is kind of a very tangential point, but if you're passing a DTB to the firmware, why would you also use firmware config to pass the address? Why not put it in the DTB?
So what was the prototype actually is to pass the DTB address into the X0 register, and then the DTB would be parsed. So it was parsed in assembly code, actually, because we have no stack at this moment. And the problem is that it leads to 200 lines of code, so it's not maintainable. So actually, this approach was not supported by the maintainer. So we are looking more closely at the firmware config ID, where we would pass actually the RAM base, or so it's easier to.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you don't know where the firmware config device is unless you've got
it. So that seems a bit chicken and egg, because you don't know where the firmware config device is until you found the device.
Yeah, so this assumes this is at a fixed location. So yeah, there is no ideal solution today. So.
No. I still think that you've got to leave the RAM base where it is. That's, of all the things in the vert board, we've basically historically said, pretty much anything in here can move. You should really look at the device tree. The one thing that we will guarantee to you is that the RAM is at the 1 gigabyte mark, and that is where you will find the device tree. So,
yeah. So the last alternative was to have this small SRAM region at 1 gigabyte, where we would put the DTB and the stack. But the problem, this is also a split memory model, because we would need to size correctly this SRAM region. So,
yeah, and I think you should also account for UEFI and Linux are not the only guests here. So you've got other things like the fiasco hypervisor stuff and people doing various random hobby and experimental projects and other non-Linux kernels and so on. And so I just think you've got to leave the RAM at 1 gigabyte. I mean, you can say for command lines which currently don't work at all, like so if the user asks for more than 255 gig of memory, you can change things around in that case. Or if the user specifically asks for device RAM, because at the moment that doesn't work, And so you could say, well, if your command line asks device RAM, obviously you're prepared for your guest to cope with it. But for the cases we have at the moment, I think you've just got to say accept that, yeah, the RAM is here.
Mm.
And yeah. So my view is that for the same reason on x86, yes, it's a pain, but you've got to support the legacy stuff. That's why x86 has is set up the way it is. And I think for ARMvert, you're probably also going to wind up having to accept that it's a pain, but we do have legacy stuff here. So you've got to keep supporting that and also add your new stuff. So I think that maybe just do it the way x86 does it. That's my best view.
Okay.
Okay, so thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for your attention.